Network troubleshooting using Wireshark.
All right. At FabianToro7146 writes, "Wow, well done. Fantastic demonstration. In fact, I can understand the conversation because that's my native language. Following the invitation at the end of your video, I had an issue a few weeks back and captured the packets. The problem was at the other end, but I'd like to understand who was sending a reset. How could I upload the PCAP file? Long story short, we couldn't send emails just to a specific domain." So thank you, Fabian, for sending this in. Let's take a look at the PCAP you sent. Now, if you're unfamiliar with how email protocols work, email messages are generally exchanged between email servers on the internet using a protocol known as SMTP, or Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. Now, the benefit of looking at Simple Mail Transfer Protocol in Wireshark is that the handshake process is generally plain text, meaning even if you're sending encrypted emails, the handshaking between the client and the server and the negotiation of that encryption and different parameters like authentication is done in plain text. So you can use a capture to actually deduce what's going on. So this is the capture that Fabian had sent in. A few things that I want to go through. One is that there's two different conversations. There's a primary conversation at the top, and then there is one happening just after below it. Now, look at the timestamp. It looks like two conversations happen sequentially. My assumption is that the mail server on your end tried to communicate with the remote server first in this conversation, and then it failed and went to the second one. Okay, so let's focus in on the first to start. So I'm going to right-click, applies the filter. Actually, right-click, follow TCP stream, and let's focus. So right off the bat, if we're troubleshooting, the first thing we can tell is that there is no firewall on the remote end. Now, the remote end in this case is 207.54.80.51. I believe that is Microsoft, but for the purpose of this investigation, it doesn't matter. The fact that you're actually able to see the TCP three-way handshake implies that at least at a network layer, so layer 3 and layer 4, the communication is permitted. So this remote server, 207.54, does not have a firewall that's blocking you specifically. If you were to see this SYN packet go out and nothing is coming back to you, that would imply that there is something blocking, whether it be your firewall locally or something remote on that end. And you can contact them to say, hey, I need you to whitelist my IP address. Here's my public IP. Okay. But in this case, that doesn't happen. The second thing I'll note is that the round trip time is fairly high. So if I click on a acknowledgement packet and I take a look at the RTT, I can see the RTT to active packet was 173 milliseconds. That's not horrible, but on the internet, that's like, you know, the latency between, say, North America and, you know, Eastern Europe, as an example, or somewhere in Europe. So the latency itself is not an issue, because ultimately this connection looks fairly clean. There's no retransmissions. I'm not seeing any packet loss. So even though the latency is high, it may take a little bit longer, but ultimately it doesn't really matter for this issue. Now let's look at the actual SMTP messages. Okay, starting here. So we do the three-way handshake. That's all good. In SMTP, generally speaking, the fourth packet, in this case, it's the fifth because we have a window update, which is that's okay. That's just a TCP signal. Is a let's see, let's open it up here. It's a service ready. So what this is telling you as a client is that, okay, I'm connecting on port 25. And this server is telling you that I am an SMTP server. I'm ready for connections. Okay. This is to distinguish from, say, another application running on port 25. So this is how your client knows that, hey, I'm actually connecting to this thing and it actually is speaking SMTP. Now, one thing of note that you can take a look at here, I'm not seeing the full packet size. What Fabian had done in the capture is he captured with a certain snap length or packet length. What this allows you to do is actually capture just the first X number of bytes that are going between, in the traffic, but doesn't give you the full payload. What that means for this conversation is that I'm not going to be able to see all the details in each of these messages. I'm only going to be able to see the first little bit. But that's actually better for privacy, because certain environments, they don't want you to capture the payload of traffic. They just want you to look at headers all the way up to TCP and some of the application layer headers, and this is how you do it. So in future, I'll do a video on how to do that in Wireshark to capture only some of the traffic or some of each packet, sorry, so only the header of the packet. But for now, just that's why I'm not seeing all the messages here. But Fabian, if you're looking at this, do a full capture and you can follow along with the rest of the parameters. But to continue, the server sends a 200, service ready. We, the client, Fabian, acknowledges it. Okay, the next packet needs to be a hello or an EHLO packet, which he does here. You can say EHLO. And you could see EHLO, and this is likely bright male, even though the L is cut off. That's just identifying who you are. The remote server accepts that. The remote server sends in requested mail action, okay, completed, meaning it's accepting this packet here. Now, as you're doing this analysis, just like you're doing TLS and analysis in the other video I did on TLS handshakes, when you see one of the sides acknowledging a message being sent, it means that it's okay with that message, right? There's no error. In this case, for example, we see that we send a hello to the server. The server comes back, TCP acknowledges it, meaning it got the packet, and then it sends a requested mail action, okay. So up until this point, we're good. Okay. Now we get into the point where we had some issues. The next message is a start TLS. Start TLS is a message sent by clients to tell the server, hey, I'd like to actually use TLS to encrypt and authenticate this communication because it needs to be secure. Now, every SMTP server in this day and age should support TLS. And every message sent between SMTP servers should be encrypted with TLS. So this should be default. If you don't see this, it's actually quite insecure, right? But let's see what happens. We see start TLS come from Fabian. The remote end acknowledges it. And then the remote end says 220, go ahead. So this tells you a lot in one message, right? It tells you that we've requested TLS. It tells you that the remote server says that's okay, meaning the remote server must support TLS. So whatever the problem is that is happening here, it's not that the remote server does not support TLS. It's something else, right? Otherwise, what would happen is that if Fabian sent the start TLS, it was acknowledged, and then you get the reset here in packet 12, that would imply that the remote server does not support TLS, and therefore you need to connect without using start TLS using like plain text. But that doesn't happen here. The remote server says that it supports TLS. Let's go ahead. Okay. So Fabian's side sends a client hello. Now, again, go back to the video on TLS handshake troubleshooting. The client hello in TLS is generally speaking the first message that the client sends in the TLS SSL handshake. And there's a whole number of other messages that need to be sent back and forth before the connection is truly secure. However, what happens is Fabian sends the client hello, and immediately the remote web server sends a reset. Okay. So what does that mean? Client hello, reset. If you go back to that video again, I'll keep talking about that video because it's a great video. If a remote web server closes the connection after you've sent the client hello, what that implies is that it does not like something about the client hello. Okay, so client hello is an offer from your side, so Fabian's SMTP server or client, to the remote side saying, okay, I want to use TLS. Here are all the ciphers I support. Here are all the authentication methods I support. Here's the version of TLS I have, right? I can't see all that data except for the fact that it's TLS 1.2. Because again, the packet is the capture is truncated and the packets are only 128 bytes. But in this client hello is a whole list of things that are coming from the client that say, hey, here are my parameters. Do you accept any of these things? Okay. And clearly the server does not, because the server sends a reset back right away. So to answer your question, Fabian, what's most likely happening here, the server on the other side, right? They don't have a firewall, one. They are using SMTP, two. They allow for TLS. Okay, so they accepted that. They said, go ahead once you sent the start TLS. But once you sent your client hello, then they send the reset back, implying that something in your client hello is not supported on the other end. So what I would do is do a full capture, look at your client hello, look at all the parameters that you're sending as a client, and then either contact the owner of the remote side and see what kind of, if they support your cipher suites, your version of TLS, etc. Or you could try running a test where you change some of the parameters in TLS in your client and see if that makes a difference, right? But either way, this is not a firewall problem. This is a SSL problem or TLS problem, and it seems it has to do with your parameters. So I mentioned that there's two conversations. We just went through the first one. Now, we went to the first one, TLS failed. Let's see what the client does. The client reinitiates that connection to the same address, 80.51, and it does something a little bit different this time. What I'm assuming is that this is some kind of fallback mechanism that the server or that the client is using to try to get the connection going through because TLS failed. Okay, so let's see what happens. We have SYNCNACAC. We get the 220 from the server again, service ready. We do the EHLO again. Okay. Requested mail action. Okay. We get a mail from message here. Okay. This is one of the messages within the SMTP protocol. We get a message coming back from the server saying authentication is required, 5:30. Okay. And then what happens is Fabian side acknowledges it, but then immediately goes to quit. Okay. At the remote end acknowledges the quit, and then closing transmission channel 221, and then the connection closes. So what appears to have happened here is that, again, we tried to connect over TLS, that failed. Tried to connect again. You notice that we don't have a start TLS message after the 250. Okay. The 250 is here, and instead we go straight into mail from. But the server says authentication required, and then the connection fails. So it could be two things. It could be that the client tried to send authentication to the server and it was invalid, meaning that, you have a username password configured and that just doesn't work. Or it could be that you don't have any credentials configured on your client at all. And what's happening is the server saying, hey, you need to send me some credentials. The client, which is you, say, I don't have any. I'm going to close it and close it off. So clearly, if you're connecting to this server on plain text SMTP, it requires authentication. Maybe this is a specialty service, I think Brightmail is like a spam service or like a for scanning spam email. So maybe you need to have like an account with Microsoft in order to let them accept your connection, and double check your client to make sure that if you do have an account and you have authentication, like username, password, that you've actually configured it. But that's what's happening in this one. So this one is failing because of authentication. Double check your authentication on your side. Double check the mail server on the remote end to see if they need authentication, and you should be able to figure it out. That's it for this video. I hope you found this video useful. If so, please like and subscribe. Also, if you have an issue that you're working on and you would like to review the capture on the channel or get some advice, feel free to post a link to it below with a description, and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. Until next time.